Good morning, colleagues, and welcome to the first meeting in 2017 of the Finance and Constitution Committee. Can I wish all my colleagues around the table a Happy New Year, and the clerking team also, and obviously Robert Choate from the OBR. I've got an apology from Madam Tompkins this morning. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Thank you, members are agreed. The second item of our agenda is to take evidence from the Office of Budget Responsibility and its reports on the economic and fiscal outlook and devolved tax forecasts, both of which were published alongside the UK autumn statement in November. And we're joined for this item by the chairman of the OBR, Robert Choate, and I very warmly welcome Robert to the meeting. And Robert, I don't know if you've got a short opening statement you would like to make, or if you wish to do that, please feel free.
Fine. Well, thank you very much indeed, convener. It's a great pleasure to be here. Perhaps just by way of introduction, as you say, the last set of forecasts, which I know the clerks have circulated details to everybody, were alongside the autumn statement on November the 23rd. The next set of forecasts that we produce will be alongside the UK budget on March the 6th, so we haven't done any updates of the material since then. I think, needless to say, if you look at the differences between the forecasts that we published back in March of last year and then the subsequent ones that we produced back in November, at one level, the sort of the big picture story of an outlook of relatively steady but unspectacular growth, certainly by the standards of periods of growth after a recession, remains in place. Obviously, the main or the continuing major uncertainty around that forecast, and I think around anybody doing an economic forecast over a 5-year or so period, is the outlook for productivity. This has been the defining puzzle of this economic recovery. The fact that productivity, which is the amount of output you get out of every hour that an individual works, has grown much less quickly than has been historically the case. That's not unique to the UK. It's, I think, probably more pronounced in the UK than elsewhere, but it has led to a greater sense of pessimism about the medium to long-term growth prospects of the economy, as I say, not unique to the UK. So I think, obviously, the most newsworthy thing that happened between March and November was, of course, the referendum vote by the UK to leave the European Union, and that creates its own set of uncertainties around the forecast, both in terms of the ongoing response to the vote itself and the uncertainties around what will eventually emerge from the negotiations. But I think it's very important to remember that the uncertainty surrounding Brexit has not displaced or replaced the existing uncertainty about the outlook for productivity, the outlook for the global economy. It's come on top of that. And I think it's easy to forget those underlying senses of uncertainty by focusing too much on Brexit. And indeed, if you look over the coming years and decades and the performance, the long-term growth performance of the economy, the productivity performance of the economy surprises people on either the upside or the downside. Interminable PhD theses are going to be written on whether this was to do with Brexit or whether it was to do with the resolution or the evolution of the underlying productivity puzzle. So I think that's important to remember. In addition, I think it's also, obviously people are very focused at the moment on what the flow of new economic data coming in tells you about the response to the immediate response to the no vote, whether the economy is holding up or not. I think there's a great temptation, obviously, for people to fixate on either the weak bits of data or the strong bits of data, depending on whether that supports the previous argument that they've had. But I would be very cautious about placing too much weight at this stage on, you know, the monthly numbers, the quarterly numbers that we get out of the Office for National Statistics on the performance of the economy at this stage. We are dealing here with the very early drafts of economic history, and experience shows that that can be substantially rewritten. You only need to look, there'll be particular focus, I think, over the next few quarters on the performance of business investment. Go back to 2009, there are huge variations in not merely the forecasts of what was happening to business investment, but the estimates of what actually happened after the event. You know, I think in the second quarter of 2009, the estimates of the change in business investment on the previous quarter ranged from an increase of 1 to a decrease of 11 or 12, and it's now put at minus 5. So that gives you some sense of the changes there. It's tempting occasionally to look at economic forecasting and treat it as a spot the ball competition. Well, it isn't like that, or if it is like that, it's a spot the ball competition in which you have to be prepared for the judges to change their minds repeatedly about where the ball is, and often many years after the closing date of the competition. So I think you have to have that sense of wariness. Maybe just one remark on the devolved tax forecasts before going to questions. Obviously, we produced our forecasts in November. It's been possible now to compare those to those produced by the Scottish Government in the December draft budget. I think, for example, if you look at income tax, the largest one, the differences between our forecasts and the Scottish Government forecasts are small in comparison to the uncertainty that lies around either one of those forecasts over the horizon that we're looking at. So I would not regard those differences as being significant or worrying. They will reflect things like differences in modelling approach, differences in some of the information that people have been able to take on board, different assumptions about the performance of growth and earnings over the next few years. For LBTT, rather larger differences, but that I think is only to be expected given the nature of that tax, and the same is true for the rest of the UK equivalent. It is of its nature a much more volatile tax, bigger movements in housing transactions, housing prices than you get in wages and salaries. So I think the key thing from us, and I know this is a shared objective we have with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, is to be able to look at these numbers and to be able to highlight for people why they may be differences there. But as I say, I think one has to expect those differences. It's not something to worry about, and it is another symptom or manifestation of the uncertainty around economic and fiscal forecasting that I referred to earlier.
I was going to ask you at the beginning to talk about how difficult this science of forecasting was and what that would mean for us in terms of a committee, but I think you've exploited that very well in terms of your description on the spot the ball. But I guess for us, whether it's spot the ball or finger in the air to work out what's going on, for us in Scotland, the issue is what are the variables going to be and the difference between what happens in the rest of the UK and Scotland. And I'm not sure if you could provide us any insight in where you think the challenges are for us in these potential variables compared to what might happen in the UK performance compared with the Scottish performance, given the uncertainty around what the numbers actually mean.
Yes, well, again, I would come back to the fact that that any uncertainty about the differences in performance between Scotland and the rest of the UK are probably dwarfed by the uncertainties around the performance of either in isolation. I think, again, coming back to the productivity issue, the biggest and perhaps most important uncertainty for both us and for the Scottish Government now and the Fiscal Commission in terms of producing forecasts in the future is the outlook for productivity growth and what that implies for growth in average earnings, which is obviously a key driver of the income tax forecast. So, as I say, we've had this period of very weak productivity performance since the financial crisis. We are assuming that potential productivity growth and potential growth in the economy as a whole does pick up over the next 5 years, but doesn't get back to its historically average rate at the end of that period. However, nonetheless, making that assumption of a pickup is sufficient to get average earnings growth year on year in the UK for in our forecast up to 3.75% by 2020 or thereabouts. And I think the Scottish Government has a figure slightly above 4% here. Whether that's actually a genuine difference or a difference in exactly which year on year or month on month comparison it is, I'm not sure. But we're both engaged in part in an act of faith that we get back to something more like the performance of the past rather than the recent very weak performance being the new normal. If that is the new normal, that's bad news for wages, it's bad news for living standards, and it's bad news for the public finances as well. So that, I think, would be a key one. So I think the Scottish Government's approach at the moment in the forecasting is essentially to take our forecast for the UK as a whole for average earnings, and then to use their own modelling techniques to discern any differences that are important for Scotland. That seems a very sensible approach. Obviously, the Fiscal Commission will have decisions to make about how much of a forecasting exercise they undertake on their own on the macro economic side. But that, I think, is the major underlying uncertainty there. I think that it's interesting that in terms of the differences in modelling approach, the Scottish Government, in producing its in its income tax forecast, has taken an interesting approach of looking at an approach that sort of disaggregates by different ages, whereas for us, we are more troubled both in the income tax forecast and in the LBTT forecast by the difference between London and relatively high-end properties and income movements and the rest of the UK, as distinct from a Scotland versus rest of the UK story, which is one reason why we have different techniques. But that will be an important issue as well. But if I had to underline one key uncertainty, both in terms of the performance in both Scotland and the UK and in any differences, earnings growth and productivity growth would be a key one.
And obviously there are clear similarities between the OBR forecast and the Scottish Government's forecast, but these forecasts seem to, are more optimistic than forecasts from renowned companies and organisations who seem to be projecting lower forecast growth than either the Scottish Government or the OBR. Have you any sense of why that might be?
Yes, I mean, if you look at our forecast for GDP growth this year and out over the next 5 years, we're somewhat more optimistic than the Bank of England's most recent forecast back in November, and we're somewhat more optimistic than the average of outside forecasters polled by the Treasury. There are some people who argue we are nonetheless nowhere near optimistic enough, and that great opportunities present themselves, and that will show up in a much stronger growth performance. I think partly it depends on when these forecasts were made. Obviously, if you're averaging a whole lot of outside forecasts, some of them will be relatively old, some of them will be relatively new. If you take the particular impact of Brexit on the potential performance of the economy over the near-ish term, the next couple of years or so, the judgment we've basically made is that you would see some slowdown in the economy, partly reflecting the impact of uncertainty on business investment, businesses likely to cancel or to delay some projects. And also, we have seen a sharp fall in the pound since the referendum. That pushes up import prices and would therefore be expected to squeeze consumer budgets, in particular through this year and into next year. Now, so that means that even if consumers continue to spend in cash terms what they were going to spend anyway, it makes less of a contribution to real GDP growth because you're buying less stuff with every pound that that they're spending. I think some of the more pessimistic forecasts were in addition assuming that there would be a hit to business and consumer confidence sufficient for consumers to increase their precautionary saving, i.e. to tighten their belts out of a sense of anxiety, and that in some cases firms would engage in more aggressive job shedding because of the potential impact of Brexit. We haven't taken that view. We've focused more on a sort of, as I say, some delay or cancellation of investment projects and the squeeze via higher prices. But I think some of the gloomier views, and this would certainly be true of some of the gloomier views published ahead of the referendum, it was assuming a more aggressive reaction by consumers and businesses than we have and than the evidence suggests to date that there has been.
Helpful, Robert. Ash?
Yes, you've covered some of my question already because it was about productivity, the assumptions around the productivity growth, because you said yourself in your report that it was the most important uncertainty. So I saw a tweet by Danny Blanchflower, and he said the OBR really must explain their assumptions around why they think the productivity puzzle will be solved in the next 5 years, and your comments on Brexit there as well. It seems to me that, you know, over the next 5 years, it's relatively short term. We've got a lot of impacts around Brexit, some of which we're not really sure what they'll be yet, but certainly we've already seen, you know, business investment is down. Do you not think that that would play into productivity and therefore assuming that productivity growth will return in the sort of short term? I mean, why did you make that assumption?
Well, we have taken down the forecast for productivity growth over the next 5 years, partly as a result of the Brexit vote. The link that we've emphasised, or that we emphasised in our last report, is that if you have less business investment, there's, you know, less capital being provided to businesses, and that in itself leads to weaker productivity growth. So we have that chain operating there. The Treasury, in their analysis ahead of the referendum, also emphasised the fact that they assumed that if you had a less trade-intensive economy, and most people are assuming that at least over the sort of time horizon we're looking at here, maybe not over the much longer time horizon, that you would just get less imports and exports than you otherwise would have done as we move to a new trade regime, that in itself means less innovation and less productivity growth. So there's another potential channel there. I think in terms of going back to the broader question, Danny's question, which, as it were, precedes the referendum anyway, of, you know, why do we assume that there is a pickup of productivity growth at all? I think the challenge for forecasters at the moment is that you're looking at two very different periods of history, a period of decades in which productivity growth was relatively strong, and then a very weak performance since the financial crisis, and as I say, not unique to the UK. So in terms of what you forecast for the next few years, essentially everybody has to wait, you know, how important the, you know, much longer period of relatively strong performance and the shorter period of subsequent relatively weak performance is as a guide to where you're going to be in the future. Perhaps not entirely surprisingly, we go somewhere between the two. We assume that, you know, things won't remain as weak as they have done since 2008-09, but that they don't get back to the sorts of productivity growth rates that you saw previously. So I would dispute the notion that we're assuming that the productivity puzzle is solved. We assume that there is some, you know, return towards the sorts of rates of improvement that you've seen in the past. Part of the reason, again, for sort of, you know, for that that in-between judgment is that there is considerable uncertainty over what the explanations for the productivity puzzle are. If you knew why it was that productivity had been so weak, you could then make a much more definitive judgment about whether you thought the next few years were likely to be different. And there are a range of alternative views out there, that we're not measuring these things properly, that it is the weakness of business investment, that it's something to do with the buoyancy of trade at a global level. Is it to do with the fact that there are just simply less good, potentially profitable ideas out there for people to invest in? The Bank of England in particular has thrown a lot of person power at this question, and, you know, have concluded there is no single defining explanation for this, but lots of individual things can explain part of it. So our view that, you know, it's too pessimistic to assume that, you know, we never get back to anything like the 2% productivity growth that we've had in the past. You know, what's the evidence for that? It's, you know, it is a judgment of going somewhere between the two of those. What we do in the report, and what we did in this one, is to show the implications for the public finances if the recent past is the new normal, or if we get back to the performance in the past. Not entirely surprisingly, if the recent past is the new normal, that is not good news for growth in tax receipts, for the public finances, and would make it much harder for the government to hit the fiscal rules that it has set itself. So as I said in the opening remarks, it does to some degree remain an act of faith that we get back to something more like normality, but we are not assuming that we, you know, certainly not assuming that we recover the level of productivity you would have expected prior to the crisis, and over the horizon we're looking at, not even the growth rate.
Okay, thank you.
Dean?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just your last question answer covered a number of issues I was going to touch on, but I understand variations in levels of productivity exist across the UK, with London rates of productivity in London being higher, and there are variations in productivity across sectors. Could you talk us through, do your forecasts break down productivity levels on a regional basis or a sectoral basis? Or if they don't go into that level of detail, can you give us some kind of flavour of what your view is in terms of productivity levels across different parts of the UK going forward and across different sectors, please?
Yeah, I'm afraid I would have to leave that to others. Because the The remit we've been given is to produce, I mean, we only produce a macroeconomic forecast at all in order to produce a forecast for the UK-wide public finances, supplemented by the additional requirements to do devolved tax forecasts for here in Wales. So we don't produce a forecast that's disaggregated by region within England, for example, or by nation, or indeed by sector. So it's not something on which I could give you, you know, it would just be armchair theorising, but I would leave it to people who've looked at that in more detail. That's not to say, of course, that isn't a very important policy issue, but obviously from our point of view, we're looking at aggregate tax receipts, aggregate spending for the UK public finances as a whole, so it's not something that we work on specifically.
Thank you. Good morning. I was just interested in some of what you were saying in relation to jobs, and I think the phrase you used was, if I can get it, we do not at this stage forecast that Brexit-related uncertainty will prompt more aggressive job shedding. I'm just wondering if you can explain why you haven't looked at the possible implications there. I mean, the one of the documents that we've been using to inform our discussions over recent months is the Fraser of Allender report that suggests that even under a situation in which we stayed in the EEA but came out of the EU, the impact would be something around the order of 40,000 jobs lost in Scotland and a drop of £1,000 in average wages. You know, the consequence of that is not about people being cautious and saving more. It's about them not having enough money for the things that they need at the moment. So can you say a little bit about why you haven't included any kind of scenarios around the employment impact of the Brexit situation and the different paths that we might come into?
One issue in terms of the approach we've taken to the Brexit policy as a whole, and the assumptions that we've made, we're constrained here by the remit we've been given and the legislation that's been set out for us, which requires us to focus on the forecasts have to be produced on the basis of current government policy, and we're not allowed to look at different policy options. Now,
out of the European Union.
It is, exactly. So that's the reason why, in advance of the referendum, we didn't produce a forecast of what would happen if there was a no vote. Subsequent to it, we basically had to decide whether we would try to predict the precise outcome of the negotiations and use that, as it were, as your definition of current government policy and base the forecast on that. And clearly, as you say, some institutions have produced different forecasts for different potential trade regimes. Whether any of those, you know, particular models ends up being one that the UK ends up with, or whether the UK has a quote-unquote bespoke or just a different one from anywhere else, only time will tell. So the decision that we took was that rather than to pretend that we could predict exactly where this was going to end out, we would make some relatively broad brush assumptions consistent with what external studies would suggest would be true of a wide variety of the outturns. And that is basically to say that over the five-year horizon that we're looking at, that you would have less trade, somewhat less inward migration, less investment than you otherwise would have done. That's what we've explained clearly in the report, and that's how we've proceeded. And then, you know, as things get clearer, we can change that. How quickly things will get clear enough for us to change it, I think, is a matter of change. Now, in terms of unemployment and the labour market specifically, we do have unemployment rising relative to what would have been the case in the previous forecast, and that's partly because, as I say, you have this weakness in business investment, the squeeze on consumers, which means that some spare capacity will open up in the economy, and there will be some additional unemployment as a result of that, which would be typical of when an output gap, as it's referred to, in the economy opens up, but that you would expect to close down. Over the longer term, we are assuming that there is weaker productivity performance than otherwise would have been, and weaker potential GDP, and that pulls that down. So I think in terms, when we said the quote you said about we've not assumed more aggressive job cutting, in a sense that's a sort of tautologist statement, we've made made an assumption, and we obviously haven't made the assumption that's more aggressive than that. As I say, crucially, we have focused in the scenarios that we've put in on what happens if you end up with a weaker productivity performance, and that has considerable implications for the public finances, but more importantly for wages and for living standards.
And given that you are required to operate under the assumption of current UK government policy, does that also apply to their immigration policy? The UK government's policy is to bring net migration to the tens of thousands. Some of us think that's a bad idea and probably unachievable as well. But are you assuming that that will actually happen and what the economic consequences of that would be?
We are assuming that again, obviously, we don't know what the migration regime the government is going to either choose or emerge from negotiations with is going to be. So, again, we've made a relatively... Sorry?
You know what their policy objective is.
We know what their policy objective is, and that policy objective has obviously been there for some time. And our forecasts, while they've taken the objective, we've taken on board the objective, we've never assumed that they would succeed in getting... migration down to that sort of level anyway.
Okay.
And we continue not to assume that in the projections that we've made in this forecast. So we have,
right.
I think, net inward migration settling down at around 185,000 a year rather right. than the high tens of thousands.
So basically on both of these two aspects, if the UK government achieves what it intends to achieve, the two more big heaps of bad to work into these figures.
Yeah, I mean, I think one point to bear in mind is that... how bad you think the implications for the economy are depends on whether you look at GDP for the economy as a whole or GDP per capita. Obviously, the effect on GDP per capita is smaller, because obviously the economy would be smaller if there are fewer people contributing to it. The size of the economy per person in it would not be affected to quite the same degree. But it is, conventional, certainly in the analysis that we've produced. You see the same thing in... analysis for the United States by the Congressional Budget Office that over a sort of, a near but quite long time horizon, lower net inward migration is bad news for the public finances, primarily because net inward migrants are more likely to be of working age than the rest of the population. Now, obviously, if you run that on over, those people get older eventually, and all the time. But the fiscal implications will evolve
later.
Over time. But generally speaking, and we again show the variance here. If you have lower net inward migration, the outlook for the public finances is less good. But it's not our job to say what migration policy would be, and obviously governments set migration policy not only with an eye to what this means for the public finances, and if they want to take a view that has negative implications for the public finances, they could take other tax and policy spending decisions to offset that. So we're not saying that you need to have this particular level of net inward migration to deliver a particular outcome for the public finances, nor are we saying this is the level of, we do not believe you should get net inward migration down to the high tens of thousands. That sort of policy advice is beyond our scope. We're just trying to say what we think the most likely outcome will be under those different circumstances.
Thank you very much.
Ivan's a supplementary to this.
Thanks, convener. Yeah, thanks. I was just going to follow up on some of the stuff Patrick had spoken about there on population, and you've kind of answered it. You've got a number of 185,000, which you're using. Now, the data we've seen, and I don't know if it's the same data you're using, the ONS population forecasts are growing by more than 400,000 a year over the next 5 years. Now, the vast majority of that is going to be inward immigration. I think there's maybe about 75% of that's going to be inward immigration, which I think is consistent with where we've been over the last number of years. So I'm assuming your 185 number is some kind of step down, and you've actually got a line in your forecast that projects a public sector finance impact to that lower migration, which actually gets up to about £6 billion. Pound difference by 2021, which is obviously significant even with that step down. So it was really just to drill some more into that. And you talked about GDP versus GDP per capita, but as you also rightly said, at the end of the day, it's the GDP number that drives the public sector finances, not the per capita number. So I suppose that the question is, have you done any modelling at all on the assumption that the government has got any chance of hitting its stated objective because it seems a bit kind of strange to, given that 17 million people voted, were led to believe, for lower immigration, and that's a stated government policy, but you're kind of saying neither of those matter because there's no chance in hell of them happening anyway, so we're just going to ignore that. Seems a bit kind of strange.
I leave it to you to say whether 17 million people voted for that is a, you know, is what they voted for. I think difference view, you know, differences on, you know, what the level of migration ought to be as distinct from its composition and the degree of control that the government can exercise over it offers differs amongst the people who voted the way they did in the referendum anyway. But I mean, more generally, the approach we take basically to make the forecast tractable is, as you imply, to pick amongst the variant population projections that are produced by the Office for National Statistics, and we try to pick the one that we think looks most consistent with the current stated government policy and other, you know, external and other influences on migration flows. So at the moment we are using the ONS's principal migration principal population variant, projection variant, which assumes that net inward migration starts at relatively around the levels you've seen in recent years and then moves over 5 years towards a more long-term average. So when the ONS produces its population projections, they are not doing a detailed study of whether they think that the, you know, the regime is going to deliver particular outcomes. It is a more mechanistic approach that basically says, you know, the most recent past is the best guide to the near future, and the longer history is perhaps a better guide further on, and that we take that on board. I think, as we've said in the report, in the absence of the Brexit vote, we would probably have moved to the higher net inward migration variant from the ONS, simply because the most recent inflow rates have continued to be relatively high. The decision not to do that partly reflects, again, the assumption that most external studies say that or suggest that the outcome of negotiations would be moving to something with a, and given what the government said, as you say, more likely to be a tighter than a looser migration policy. But in addition, and perhaps more important in the nearer term, is that you assume that the pull factors, that, you know, the degree to which people are attracted to come to the UK is less than it otherwise would be because the economy would be weaker and for other effects as well. So the fact that you've taken a lower net inward migration assumption than you otherwise would have done is not simply or mainly a judgment about the fact that we assume they're going to introduce a particular migration control regime which is going to let fewer people in, but that you're also more likely to see a smaller inflow in anyway because of the relative performance of the economy.
Yeah. So basically, saying is the best way to reduce immigration is to crash the economy because nobody will want to come here then.
Those are not words that we used.
Just to follow through on that. So basically, saying is the ONS assumption has effectively ignored Brexit because they've said this is what's happened in the past and we believe that's the best guide to what's going to happen in the future. And I suppose it comes back to my question, have you done any number crunching on an assumption that immigration would be in the tens of thousands, and what does that look like?
If you go back to the previous economic and fiscal outlook that we produced in March, we did indeed do a set of different scenarios based on different outcomes for net inward migration. That wasn't specifically on the basis of different policy regimes, but the way in which the ONS produces different population projection variants for different migration rates is simply to take the principal rate and then say, well, let's assume that the end point is 60,000 higher or lower, draw the line differently, and then that comes out. So we've been able to use that to show some of the differences. And, it was that analysis that we published in March that we've basically deployed again here in illustrating the potential impact of not moving to the higher migration point in this forecast. But as I say, generally speaking, if you assume lower net inward migration, the mechanical effect on the public finances is that it's weaker because of the...
That's not a year number. It's not our lowest tens of thousands number.
No, and if it was lower than that, As I say, you can see from the March forecast the sort of difference
so
that it's made. So, right, yes, okay, exactly. So you can look at above and below.
Thanks.
Thank you. Murdo?
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to ask a couple of questions, if I can, about your projections for income tax, particularly in relation to the devolved taxes, which, as you will imagine, is of a great deal of interest to this committee, given that the budget we're about to scrutinise will contain for the first time the full devolution of income tax to Scotland. Now, the Office for Budget Responsibility have published their own assumptions, and they are suggesting that the Scottish share of UK income tax revenues is expected to increase, albeit fractionally. So they're expecting a relatively higher growth in Scottish income tax compared to the rest of the UK. I was wondering if you had a view on that, whether you thought the OBR were correct in that assumption.
We wouldn't have made it otherwise. I mean, that is the assumption that we made. As you say, I think that the difference, the share is relatively stable if you look over this period. The way in which we look at the share going forwards is to say, in particular, so are there a particular sets of policy measures that are likely to have an asymmetric effect between Scotland and the rest of the UK that is likely to move that share? Now, generally speaking, if you have policy measures that affect the top end of the income distribution or the bottom end of the income distribution to a greater degree, then that's going to have a different impact in the UK, in Scotland and in the rest of the UK, simply because of the differences in income distribution. So a measure that changes the personal allowance and takes people out at the bottom is going to have a higher proportionate impact on receipts here than it will do in the rest of the UK. Changes at the top, if you increase taxation at the top, it's going to take more proportionately out of receipts in the rest of the UK than it does here. So it's those sorts of adjustments. But as you can see here, or you can see from the report there, these are relatively small differences over time. Another thing that we do in the forecast that we produce is that we can make different assumptions about whether earnings growth is going to be higher for people on relatively high incomes versus on relatively low incomes, or higher or lower. And again, because of the differences in income distribution, that can have an impact as well. In terms of the specific plans that have been put out in the draft budget, as I understand them, we're talking here about raising the higher rate threshold less quickly and the personal allowance, in effect, using a zero band more quickly than would be the case in the current UK policy. That's obviously going to have offsetting effects on revenues. The not raising the high rate threshold as quickly will bring more in, raising the personal allowance by more will bring less in. Obviously, when we produced our November forecast, that wasn't, you know, Scottish Government policy firmly at that stage. When we produce our March forecast, we will be able to incorporate that, and we will produce an explicit estimate of the net effect on receipts of making that change relative to continuing to stick with the UK policy line. My guess at this point is that the numbers are not enormous, and as I say, there are offsetting effects at the top and the bottom, but we'll look at that more carefully when we get to the next forecast in March.
Okay, thank you for that. Perhaps I could just follow this up, because I heard everything you had to say. Your forecasts, though, are suggesting that although the difference is marginal, the Scottish income tax revenues will grow faster than the rest of the UK income tax revenues, and it relatively. Are you saying that you think that income tax revenues per capita in Scotland will therefore grow faster than the rest of the UK?
I'm not sure what the answer to that question would be. I can get back to that. I don't know over this period what's happening to the relative population growths over this period. If I can dig that out, I can get back to you.
Okay, thank you. I mean, that'd be useful. I mean, one of the challenges, you know, that we have in relation to the Scottish economy is we know the Scottish economy relative to the UK economy has over recent years not been performing as well in terms of GDP growth. Unemployment in Scotland relatively is higher, and employment relatively is lower than the rest of the UK, which is why suggestions of faster income tax growth in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK seem out of kilter with what's happening elsewhere in the economy. I've just one further question, if I can, convener. Have you looked at all?
Yeah. It's interesting, certainly make the comparison with Wales. I mean, the performance of Scotland versus the rest of the UK in things like employment rates and in unemployment rates is not actually that different, I don't think. And in employment rates, it's rather more different. It's lower in Wales because of lower activity rates, whereas the employment rates in Scotland, as for the UK as a whole, are not that different. I mean, they bounce around, but I think if you look on the devolved publication that we produced on page 10, it's clearly a lot more similar in Scotland and the rest of the UK than it is in Wales and the rest of the UK.
Well, maybe we have ambition to be better than Wales, at least. But the final thought I had on that very point, have you done any work to look at what would be the improvement in the income tax take in Scotland if the Scottish economy grew at the same rate as the average for the UK, or if employment and unemployment rates in Scotland match the UK average?
No, we haven't. That would be outside the scope of what we would do. You might be able to infer some of that from the data that we published, but we're focused on basically producers. So the approach we take of generally having a UK forecast and then looking at the share and whether there are reasons to expect that share to move, that's the approach we're taking. If you look at the Scottish Government's approach, it's a different sort of bottom-up forecast, looking at the different sources of income, differentiating by age, and from their point of view, it may be possible to take their forecast and say, well, if you shifted the particular assumed employment or activity rates at different ages, that you could do that comparison. I suspect it would be slightly harder with the methodology that we use, but that's off the top of my head.
All right, thank you.
James.
Okay, thanks a lot, convener. As we've been discussing, economic growth is always important, particularly relating to productivity. But we're particularly interested in this committee because of the changes in relation to devolved taxes and also the block grant adjustment and how differential growth rates can affect that. So it's interesting sort of looking ahead, although the growth rate in Scotland is lower in terms of the forecast and your forecast over 17-18 and 18-19, the trend is broadly similar. But when you get to 19-20, the Scottish Government are forecasting just a small increase from the previous year of 0.1%, but the OBR forecasting an increase of 0.4%, getting up to 2.1% in 19-20. So I just wondered,
which number are you referring to, 2.1%?
The UK growth rate forecast for 19-20.
Right.
And what I'm interested in is the jump from 18-19 of 1.7% to 2.1%, and what basically has driven you to make that forecast?
Well, at the UK level, this comes back to the assumption that in the near term, we assume that there will be a weakening in activity in the economy because of the squeeze on consumers and the weakness of business investment, although there is clear, significant uncertainty both about the size and the timing of that effect. If that happens, you open up a greater margin of spare capacity in the economy, i.e. there's some potential that could be used up before the Bank of England would worry about the potential inflationary implications of having the economy motoring at that sort of rate. So if you have a situation in which you create a bit of a hole in the economy to start with, you then end up with a period of stronger than long-term growth as that hole is filled in again. You would normally get this story quite dramatically illustrated in the wake of a recession when, let's say, the economy normally chugs along at 2% a year, you then have a recession. It's then not unusual to have the economy growing by 3 or 4% a year for a couple of years, as it were, as you climb out of the hole on the other side. What has been, very unusual about this recovery is that you've not had that period of 3 to 4% growth and you've essentially just got back to the sort of previous trend. In other words, the whole potential path of the economy appears to have shifted lower. But in microcosm, that's what's going on here. You have the economy able to pick up a bit, because in the nearer term, there's greater spare capacity created by the short-term downturn. Now, in terms of the difference between our forecast and whatever what the Scottish government is assuming for growth in the Scottish economy, I don't know what they're assuming precisely, but as I understand it, they have a bespoke version of the National Institute's economic model. They take our assumptions for what is happening in the UK as a whole, feed that into the model, and generate some Scottish-specific numbers that come out of that. What the mechanics of that are, and whether those would be systematically lower than the UK number that we provide in the first place, or whether there are other specific elements, you'd have to ask them. But I think basically, you know, we produce a forecast for growth across the UK as a whole. They take that, and the same would be true of earnings growth, stick it into their own model and generate a Scottish number out of that. As I say, I don't know what the mechanics are of the differences between the two.
And I'm not asking you to, it's obviously the Scottish Government forecast is a matter for them. I'm not asking you to, you know, speculate on why there's a difference. I'm just interested in your trend, and you've described the situation.
Basically, you get into something of a hole, and then there's a period of above trend growth while you climb out of it.
Right, okay.
Can I ask you about the growth of incorporations? Because of the, I think, that, if I recall correctly, there's a comment in your report about that. Now, obviously, for the UK, given that they'll still get a tax take out of incorporation growth, although it will still impact on their income tax and it will still be a negative outcome from them. I suspect the situation in Scotland, if that trend is the same here, is somewhat different, given that it will impact on our income tax, and actually the Treasury might get some gain out of it, perversely. Do you think there's have you got any views on the impact that may have in Scotland compared with the rest of the United Kingdom, given also that we've got a smaller number? Yeah. Higher tax.
Yes, it's not something we distinguish at that level. Obviously, we're taking into account in the forecast of Scottish income tax receipts that we produce. It's based on a share of the UK forecast, and one of the reasons we've revised down the UK forecast is by looking again at this trend in incorporations, which, as you say, you know, seems to have been rising more quickly than we had previously assumed. There's a debate about how much that is to do with the particular tax advantage for people of being companies as distinct from employees or self-employed, versus whether it's more underlying structural trends in that there are certain industries in which it is just more efficient, whatever the tax arrangements happen to be, to organise yourself in that sort of way. But we've put that into the UK forecast, so therefore it will feed into the Scottish forecast. In the UK corporation tax forecast, there is an offset there. Clearly, there is a loss to the Exchequer overall, because you assume to the degree that it is tax incorporated, it's because people know that they would be paying less in corporation tax than they would have been paying in income tax, and therefore there's that loss. But, you know, part of the loss of income tax receipts is, as you say, offset on the corporation tax receipts. To what degree that matters, for Scotland specifically, because you're seeing the hit on the income tax side, whereas the corporation tax side presumably would. You know, it feed through some way into the block grant adjustment, from which we steer very clear. Those are deep waters. But no, so we haven't looked at the Scottish-specific implications. But certainly, our Scottish income tax forecasts reflect the judgments we've made on incorporations in the UK forecast.
I suspect you said you're going to steer clear of the BGA, because that's the obvious place that question needs to go. If there was an agreement, a fiscal agreement, in the fiscal framework, for instance, on no detriment, if we've got a situation where policy levers the UK government have introduced of encouraging people to choose incorporation to avoid paying income tax, if that is the issue that's going on, they do get some gain, but they lose more on income tax. But Scotland loses entirely from that, because people move out of income tax. I just wonder, and it's maybe something for our advisor to think about, whether or not there's a fiscal framework issue there in terms of no detriment.
Yes, as I say, judging that is not for us. I can see why that would be an interesting issue. You would come back to the question of how much of the trend in incorporation is a response to changes in policy versus the fact that there's always been a differential in the relative tax treatment. So, you know, whether what is relevant to that no detriment debate is the impact of the underlying policy difference or the impact of the way in which that difference in the relative tax advantage has changed since a particular date versus how much of the underlying trend in incorporations is actually down to the fact that it's just a lot easier for people working in, you know, business services or media, etc., to arrange their affairs in that sort of way. I can imagine hours of entertaining debate on that very subject.
This is too complex for me to even think about. I don't know why I put my head down that road. Just it's another detail around your OBR tax forecast. Don't model the UK government's commitment to raise personal allowance to £12,500. And the higher rate threshold to 50,000 by the end of the UK Parliament. What impact does that likely have on the forecast for the block grant adjustment and therefore the Scottish budget, if you're able to comment on that?
Well, again, there we are. We're constrained by the fact that we produce the forecast on the basis of currently defined government policy. Now, we have an issue here for the UK, as indeed we do with Scotland, and I think it's something we need to keep under review, of when do you regard a policy as being firm enough for our point of view to include it in the forecast. We have always taken the view that we need to have a very clear statement of what exactly you know, the government is intending to do and when it intends to do it, and we take those things in the UK context on board when they appear in the Treasury's budget documents, not when ministers stand up and say we have an aspiration to end up here or there, when it's concretely put into a budget because it matters in particular when you're going to, you know, what the path is towards that particular objective you may have for some year in the future, not just where you end up there. So we can occasionally provide illustrative numbers of what the difference it would make if you end up at that end point. And I think we have done that in the past on the income tax commitment. We have a section on policy risks in here, which I think includes that. But you know, we don't include it in the central forecast. Well, we specifically ask the Treasury at every forecast we do, is this firm policy? Are you including it in your scorecard of measures? And if they say no, then we highlight the point that that commitment has been made, but we don't include it in the forecast. I think there's an issue for us here, obviously. You know, we've not taken on board in the November forecast any Scottish Government potential decisions on the de facto personal allowance or the higher rate threshold. There's an issue about when that again becomes firm policy. I mean, I think our view at the moment is if it's in the draft budget, then when we come to do our next forecast in March, that's a strong enough, clear commitment that we put it in. Whether, you know, you're greater experts on how firm these things are at different points in the Scottish legislative process than I am. So maybe that's not the right thing to be doing, and you do tell me if it isn't. But that's basically the approach we're taking.
I'm not sure it's the legislative thing, it's the issue. It's whether or not it can be achieved, given we've got minority government. I think it's what the real issue will be at the end of the day.
Well, again, with the UK, obviously, sometimes things appear in budgets and then are dropped afterwards because there isn't parliamentary support for them, in which case we put it in when the government makes a firm commitment and we take it out when they firmly commit to not to do it.
I know we've still got this productivity conundrum that you talked about earlier, but I just wondered if the OBR had any views about what either the Scottish government or indeed the UK government could do, because both are responsible, to help grow the productivity levels in Scotland in particular. Is there any particular view at the OBR about how that might be achieved, or it's something, again, that you don't really tend to comment on?
It's beyond our remit to give advice. I mean, if you look at the sorts of things that other people have suggested, I mean, I think one of the arguments that the UK government would have made around increasing support for infrastructure spending when they announced that at the autumn statement, I presume, was partly with an eye to what implications that could have for productivity growth. There are issues about whether the financial system functions well enough to ensure that capital is reallocated effectively away from what can otherwise become zombie firms to firms where there is the potential for greater innovation and for greater productivity. So I think if you look at some of the explanations people had for why productivity performance, potential productivity performance, was so weak over the immediate period after the financial crisis, it would be the, you know, the dysfunction in the financial system and the fact that you just weren't seeing that reallocation of capital in the way that you might. So obviously policy measures that help on that score were things that were mentioned then. Obviously there's a long list of things that people suggest around education and training, etc., but it's not our role. What I would caution here, you know, this does appear to be in part a global phenomenon. So that should be borne in mind, I think, in thinking about what potentially domestic policy can do. If there is a broad trend globally that, you know, there is just less investment opportunities, or the particular type of technological progress that we've been seeing is not, you know, as conducive to investment and GDP growth than it otherwise would have been, there may be bigger picture stories there that might not be particularly amenable to domestic policy.
That's a helpful caution. Willie.
Robert, you kindly came to this committee during our away day, I think it was in August last year, and we were all pretty much in the dark then. It sounds as though, from listening to the discussion, that we're still pretty much in the dark now. And I loved your analogy with the sport the ball thing, but it seems to me it's much more close to being asked to fill in a crossword without being given any of the clues here from the discussion.
Well, that could be easier rather than more difficult.
But you did say on page 9 of your submission that you've been given no information about the government's goals and expectations, because you in any event, you want to base your forecasts on assumptions that we could not be transparent about. But given that we're in these early drafts of economic history that you mentioned in your remarks, is there a challenge for your own organisation to say, well, if you're not going to tell us what detail of your policy plans, we're going to do best case, worst case assumptions or something, to give us all something to work on? Is that maybe a challenge for yourselves to do that?
Yes, I mean, we did. And obviously a number of other forecasting outfits, in particular ahead of the referendum, did take the view of saying, well, let's try to imagine a whole variety of different trade regimes and come up with different sets of assumptions. Partly because, you know, we are required to reach a judgment whether on existing policy the government has a better than 50% chance or not of hitting its fiscal targets. We in effect have to have a central forecast in order to make that judgment. We can't just say, well, it all depends on which of a whole variety of outcomes you end up with. So we are constrained to that, and obviously we do what we can to show sensitivities, but, you know, it's not clear whether it would be consistent with our legislation, and I'm not sure how informative it would be for us to sort of make precisely calibrated estimates of what difference it would make if it was EEA versus some different trade regime, when the uncertainty surrounding any one of those would be large relative to the significance of the difference that you might put between the two of them. I think one point to bear in mind is that, you know, as I say, we felt it was important to formally ask the government when we did the forecast whether there was anything additional they wished to tell us about their goals and expectations for the negotiations. And they chose not to and just pointed us to some things that the government had said already. As you pointed out in your question, I would actually have felt very uncomfortable if they'd said, well, actually, we'd like you to take the following three things into account, but we can't share that publicly. So it was really, you know, we want to produce our forecast on the basis of assumptions that we can explain to you and to everybody else. So it was really a question for them of whether they wished to say more to everybody, not just to us. However, even if they had have said, you know, in much more detail what they were aiming for, this is a negotiation and it's not necessarily a good guide to what the outcome is going to be. So it was partly as a result of the fact that the policy objectives and expectations entirely understandably weren't set out in great detail, plus the fact that that wouldn't necessarily be a good guide to where you ended up, that led us to stick with this relatively broad brush view. And, you know, I don't think we're likely to fine-tune this, you know, forecast by forecast, depending on the latest tweak that appears in speeches about where things may or may not go. But we will keep that under review as we go along.
Time for one more on the pound, Bruce. Just existing impact. You also mentioned, Robert, the impact of the falling value of the pound, and your paper also says the depreciation of sterling will boost net trade in the short term. But what about the impact on importers? I know a company in Ayrshire where I'm from who are facing huge import costs. It's mainly electronics that they import. On balance, what's the effect here? Is it a more beneficial effect because of the falling pound? Or is that a short-term benefit only? And what could we expect to see in the medium to long term if the pound stays where it is?
It is a short-term benefit in that sense. Over the longer term, if you're looking at what's the pattern of say share of, you know, our share of world markets, etc., you have the short-term exchange rate effect, and then the assumption that we've made in the longer term that growth in both imports and exports is likely to be weaker over the time horizon we're looking at than it otherwise would have been because of the transition to new trading arrangements, whatever those exact trading arrangements end up being. So there is a net boost to economic activity, i.e. there is a net export boost in terms of the volume contribution to GDP growth in the near term. That helps to partially offset the impact of weaker business investment and the squeeze on consumers. But then over the longer term, the trade picture is more affected by the assumption that both, and it's a broad brush assumption, that both both import growth and export growth are weaker, and we assume that they're weaker, as it were, in parallel. So it doesn't change the net difference between the two. It's just you end up with a less trade-intensive economy than you otherwise would have done over this horizon. Obviously, the story could be different over a much longer one.
Okay. Thank you.
Robert, thank you very much for coming along today. It has been a helpful and informative session. Thank you for being so candid as well. It's been very helpful to us as a committee. And I think there's a couple of things you said you would follow up, particularly in regard to question that Murdo asked you. So, again, thank you very much. I now suspend this meeting to allow a change of our witnesses. Welcome back, colleagues. The third item on today's agenda is to take evidence from the Scottish Government's draft budget for 2017-18 from Derek Mackay, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution. For the record, I want to put on the committee's approach to this particular process. Until 2016-17, the previous committee's scrutiny of the draft budget tended to focus on the expenditure side of the budget, and all amounts of the draft budget were covered in a single evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary. However, as a result of the increased powers over the taxation being devolved to the Scottish Parliament, it was agreed that the scrutiny of the draft budget would take place over two separate oral evidence sessions, with one considering the revenue side and the other expenditure. This morning we will focus on the revenue side of the budget, and we'll have a chance to ask questions of the Cabinet Secretary on expenditure at our next meeting on Monday, the 16th of January. Mr. Mackay is joined by some of his officials. We have Adrian Greaswood, who is the Deputy Director of Fiscal Responsibility Division, James McClellan from the Fiscal Adjustment Team Leader, and Simon Fuller, who is the Acting Deputy Director of the Office of the Chief Economic Advisor. Welcome to you all. Cabinet Secretary, do you wish to make an opening statement?
Some brief remarks, please, Convener. Thank you for the invitation to speak to the Committee on Taxation specifically. Obviously, this is a significant draft budget with the different and new relationship that we have with our spending plans as it relates to the revenue generation from these new powers. We all want to ensure that Scotland remains attractive to live, work and invest in, and to ensure that we have resources to sustain our public services. We are holding true to our principles around certainty, convenience, efficiency and ability to pay in terms of our tax proposition. I believe there is a transparency of our position, having outlined our forecasting methodology and many of the assumptions that we've made. And I appreciate the work of the Scottish Fiscal Commission, of course, who have been through our forecast, and I appreciate the work and effort that they have put in. The draft budget document outlines the position on the fiscal framework and a clear chapter on tax, including looking at a number, as I say, of the assumptions. Now, we all know that this is complex. The new process from the fiscal framework and the budget process is complex but hopefully accessible, and our key decisions as proposed include freezing the rates in relation to income tax, proposing to increase the high rate threshold in line with inflation, which we believe, as with all our taxation position, is responsible, balanced and progressive. On business rates, I haven't insisted on a revenue neutral revaluation. That has implications, but I have proposed to cut the poundage, raise the threshold for large business supplement as well as small business bonus. Positions clear on council tax, not necessarily a matter for the budget, but I've clearly listened to this committee and others on the position around council tax and attainment, and on land building transaction tax, maintaining the rates and bans, and landfill tax rates have been uprated in line with RPI inflation. So that's the key points from the position that I've set out to Parliament. Happy to take questions, Convener.
Cabinet Secretary, obviously this is a historic budget. You'll be the first ever Scottish Minister to have the privilege, if that's the right word, to propose rates and bans for Scottish income tax. But obviously with that privilege comes challenge and responsibilities. It means that your budget's now much more dependent on the performance of the Scottish economy relative to the UK economy. And I wonder, therefore, if you could give the committee some insight into how this has changed the way the Scottish Government has approached this year's budget process and the draft budget, and your plans for future years. In particular, to what extent does your budget process need to focus much more now on longer-term macroeconomic issues such as productivity growth? And that's something that this committee has been taking a fair bit of evidence on over the course of the past few weeks.
I think that's a fair question, Convener. I'm sure all parliamentarians were always interested in issues around sustainable economic growth and all the factors and determinants around that. But because of the relationship of no longer just largely being a spending parliament, tax and spending, the relationship with more significant ministers and all parliamentarians have had to think, I think, more deeply about that relationship and decision that we are taking around our tax powers and also spending as well. So ministers will have had to and have considered their portfolio decisions and how we can stimulate and support the economy and our population and public services to ensure we arrive at the right decisions to deliver that sustainable economic growth, and also a focus on population and all the other factors that the government has to consider now in arriving at policy decisions, and also understanding the drivers and forecasts that inform this work. Of course, we are highly dependent on the forecasts, but I suppose what matters more will be the outturn figures, because we're working to forecast, but it's the actual outturn that will be assessed to determine what government essentially receives at the end of the day, with all the adjustments that will take place that we all hopefully understand as the complex nature of this. But so the key point is that the ministers and government is clearly minded to look at all the issues in considering how we are helping grow the economy to ensure that there is a positive cycle of return, to have the resources to spend on public services, the relationship that it has, rather than diminishing resources.
You know, for many years, obviously, the Scottish economy outgrew the in productivity terms, the UK economy. That's not the case in the last couple of years, particularly because of the impact of North Sea oil downturn. So what additional measures has the government been trying to, or are you introducing, to help grow that GDP level in Scotland? Because obviously the issue for us in Scotland in the future, and particularly for this committee, is going to the relative growth between the UK and here. So what additional measures are you employing that can help us in that regard?
Well, I believe that the economy is certainly still a shared issue. UK government has control over a great number of economic levers, and then there's what the Scottish government can do. And what we've been trying to do in a range of portfolio areas, whether it's on business rates, as I've described, having a competitive regime around small business bonus and changing the thresholds in the large business supplement, cutting the poundage for everyone, reducing that poundage level, so a supportive package on business rates, on the non-domestic rates, and I think on the commercial side of land and building transaction tax as well, I think is very competitive. Then on the other elements of support for the business community, for example, the Scottish Growth Scheme, or specific interventions where the government has maybe taken an approach that it might not have done in the past, so to support individual areas such as steel or shipbuilding, it's just two examples. Focusing on the enterprise agenda as well, the economic strategy around exports and growth opportunities that exist there, or supporting tourism, the market there is significant and growing in Scotland as well. So in all our portfolio areas, trying to support that economic growth, to try and improve on our position, to realise the economic opportunities that exist to grow the tax receipts. And of course, it's there are vulnerabilities at the moment, and you've touched upon oil and gas, which has had a profound impact right across tax receipts and the economic growth forecasts for Scotland. I think it has had an impact. And then, of course, the productivity challenge as well, which actually has improved since devolution relative to the rest of the UK, but much more to be done there as well. So very specific business interventions, and also trying to support the economy through research and development, attracting foreign direct investment as well, and trying to ensure that Scotland's an attractive place, as I say, to live, work and invest through every measure that we can.
If Adam Tompkins was here, and unfortunately Adam's not so well today, he would probably want to ask you about the city deals issues, because he's raised that with a number of people already, and obviously I've got an interest from Stirling perspective. And I just wonder, in terms of the government's approach to the city deals, how important you think they can be to help drive the Scottish economy forward in future years as well?
Well, I would describe them as quite organic, in that there's no set formula as to what proportion you pay and how they've emerged by way of numbers. But what has happened, as well as engagement with the appropriate partnership or local authority, UK government and Scottish government, we then work together to arrive at a deal in the end, which has differed from area to area. But I think they are quite potent in delivering and unlocking economic growth. It's largely been around infrastructure for the first big one, which of course was Glasgow and Clyde. That collaboration, which I was involved in as local government minister at the time, but it was largely around infrastructure, but there are employability strands with it as well. Good partnership working, local leadership, locally led projects largely, which is then supported by finance, with all the checks and balances coming through the assurance framework between the UK government and the Scottish government. So arguably it's unlocked resources from UK government and Scottish government into projects that should make a difference. And there's a methodology around, particularly the most advanced one around how we assess the economic benefits of that, and I think it can deliver further sustained economic growth, and we're absolutely encouraging further talks on all the other city deals. Budget provision materialises when the deal is done, and then you factor in when resources are programmed to be released.
My last question around GDP issues is, obviously you said yourself the responsibility for GDP in Scotland is a joint responsibility between the UK and the Scottish Government. You've outlined what you think the Scottish Government's approach has been. Have you any particular asks of the UK Government to help them boost the Scottish economy and the GDP here that you think may be useful?
Touched on in debate some of the work in the oil and gas sector, specifically around tax relief and incentives for further exploration and support around decommissioning. So I think there's a range of things just on that sector specifically. And then there's a wider debate about the appropriate use of borrowing as well to support capital investment. I do welcome the capital investment change of heart from the UK government on further capital investment, because I do believe that, you know, capital investment has sustained large parts of the Scottish economy through a very difficult period, and we've got ongoing capital investment plans, infrastructure plans and so on. So I think a wider look at appropriate borrowing, we had a position around current budget balance, and specifically on oil and gas, there's support that could be given there to support that sector by way of examples where I've engaged with the Chancellor.
Okay. Anyone else want to pick up any productivity issues before I go into wider tax issues? Okay, Ash.
Yes, obviously, as Bruce has mentioned, we had the OBR in this morning, and we were exploring with Robert Choate the productivity growth rate, because it's such an important assumption that underpins, obviously, the growth forecasts going forward. So the OBR is assuming a return to productivity growth of 2% in 5 years, and I believe the Scottish Government forecast kind of follows that as well. As Bruce had said, Scottish productivity had been growing at a higher rate, you know, a few years ago compared to the UK one. So I'm wondering if you just have any comments around where you think Scottish productivity rate is going, whether you think it will mirror the UK, whether you think it would be behind or maybe even ahead.
Our experience has really been down to oil and gas specifically. That's what's impacted on the Scottish economy most. Now that the forecasters are saying different things about, they are all different forecasts because we're using different methodology and there are different drivers and determinants. It's not necessarily a reflection on the Scottish economy, but I think in part about the different forecasting methods and models and determinants that are being used. But I think we would all want to drive up productivity, and some of that is around not just jobs, not just number of people in employment, but quality jobs as well, and improving research and development, and as I say, foreign direct investment. All of that will help improve the overall structure and distribution of employment, and more efficiency from that as well, and further expanding the sectors that can help contribute towards productivity.
I think, James, you had a related question.
Yeah, I think we're all agreed that promoting economic growth is very important. I'm just interested in some of the forecast figures. We had, as was said, the OBR in earlier, and in terms of their forecast growth round from 1718 through to 1920, it rises by 0.3 from 1718 to 1819. And 0.4 from 1819 to 1920 to 2.1%. Between 1718 and 1819, the Scottish Government forecast goes up from 1.3 to 1.6, which is quite similar to the, the OBR increase, but between 1819 and 1920 only increases by 0.1, whereas the OBR has an increase of 0.4%. I just wondered why the growth was kind of tailing off at that point.
I believe that it's largely the methodology rather than any major event, but for the detail of the different, I mean, because we've got our, I've got my forecasts here, can you explain some of the detail around the difference? It's not that we're suggesting economic growth necessarily would in itself be slower or less successful. It's around the assumptions and the methodology that's used to arrive at the different figures, and Simon could probably assist with that. I watched your evidence earlier on from Robert Schroeder. I think that was helpful, and I think he was able to helpfully point out just we use different models, and of course it's all forecasts. Maybe Simon could assist with that understanding.
Yeah, so what I would add to what the Cabinet Secretary has said is that when we've been doing our forecasts from about 1819 onwards, we're essentially assuming that Scotland's economy gradually returns to its trend rate of growth of about 2%. So it rises from about 1.6% in 1819 up to about 2%, which is a bit longer on average, by the end of the forecast period in 2021-22. And there's obviously a number of judgments which underpin that about some of the short-term effects unwinding and us returning to longer-term trend levels of growth and productivity and wages and such like. As the Cabinet Secretary said, the model we use is different from the OBR's model. It is based on different underpinning assumptions, but also just the manner in which the model itself operates is, you know, it's just slightly different. And so a combination of these differences in the underlying modelling framework, perhaps some of the different judgments the OBR have made in their longer-term forecasts will explain the difference. But from my point of view, I think I wouldn't want to put words in the OBR's mouth as to why they've assumed a larger growth in future years, but we've essentially assumed a gradual return to our long-term trend from 1819 onwards.
I understand, you know, different models will give you different results and there are different assumptions. The explanation we got earlier was that the UK economy, you know, having some slack in it, and basically there have been holes in parts of it, would, you know, slowly start to grow. And what their forecast is showing is like a steady growth over a period from 1718 through to 2021. What I was particularly interested in was in the figures between 1819 and 1920, where the UK figure has grown by 0.4 and the Scottish figure by 0.1. So I'm not really clear from your explanation about the model and then the assumptions. You said that overall it would grow to 2%, but why in that particular year does it seem to have stunted somewhat between 1819 and 1920?
I mean, I think it would be difficult for me to say quite... I can explain why we've assumed a gradual level of growth for that period, which is simply that when we go from 1617 up to 1819, so over that two-year period, we have a relatively fast increase of growth. We assume growth increases from 1% up to 1.6%, which is, over that period, is actually faster than the OBR assumed the change of growth will be at the UK level. And so that is the period over which we think some of the output gap, some of the spare capacity in Scotland will close. And after that, we think the rate at which it closes will gradually slow down to a longer-term average. So that's what we've been assuming. I think it may simply be that the time period over which we think this change will occur differs from the OBR. So I suspect, for example, if you look over a slightly longer period, 1617 out to 2021 as a whole, the overall evolution might be fairly similar under both forecasts, but there'll just be slight judgments in the time periods under which different assumptions and different events occur. And I think in some ways, with a lot of these forecasts, there's obviously a lot of value to be looked at looking at changes from year to year, but it is sometimes quite difficult to point to one single event which drives a difference in forecasts from one year to the other. And it's sometimes easier and more informative to look at the longer term change over a 3 or 4 year period, which will be driven more by the fundamentals.
Okay. Can I do a question on productivity as well?
Actually, it was on something. It was on income tax forecast as a supplement to James. Do you want me to leave that to later?
If we're going into income tax areas now, we'll go into murder, I think, at this stage.
Yeah. So. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I was very taken with what you said earlier about the need to recognise the underlying performance of the Scottish economy as a key driver for the tax take going forward. And this is a change from where we've been historically. You've taken the decision in this budget to create a tax differential with the rest of the United Kingdom in terms of income tax. And you'll be aware of concerns that have been raised by business organisations, amongst others, that there's a risk this sends out a message about Scotland being the highest tax part of the United Kingdom and the impact that might have on the ability to attract investment, for example. But I don't want to get into the politics of that. What I want to do is try and look at the context for that decision. Spice have told us that your budget for next year will be up £501 million in real terms on the current year. Is that a figure you would agree with?
Well, there is in this one year a real terms increase as a consequence of the decisions from last year, from March, in terms of resource and then capital, which was announced by the Chancellor in his autumn statement. So there is a real terms increase for one year. Taking, of course, into the context over a 10-year period of real terms reduction, as you know, it takes us to a figure of a 9.2% real terms reductions over the 10-year period. Well, for completeness, well, Mr. Fraser.
Well, I was just going to get on to that, Cabinet Secretary, but thank you for accepting you've got an extra £500 million in next year's budget that you didn't have in the current year. But seeing as you mentioned the historical context, let me take you, if I can, to your budget document. There's a very helpful table at Annex G on page 169, and there's a summary, it's a very long table, it takes you eventually to a summary on page 172, which gives the total Scottish Government budget from the year 2010-11 through to 2017-18. Now, what this shows is that in 2010-11, the starting point, the Scottish Government's total budget was £34.2 billion in rough terms. It dips a bit, but then comes up. Your draft budget has a figure of £37.95 billion. Doesn't look to me like there's a cut there, Cabinet Secretary.
In terms of the total period over when the Tories have come into office, there is a real terms reduction, as I say. There's a real terms reduction in terms of our discretionary spend.
Well, with respect, the table in your own budget document is showing for the period you're talking about, from 2010-11 to 2017-18, the budget goes up from £34.2 billion to £37.9 billion. Where's the cut?
Well, Mr. Fraser, I'll say to you again, there is a real terms reduction in terms of our actual real terms spend, in terms of the financial power that we have.
So why is your budget document telling me something completely different?
Well, it's not. These figures are accurate in terms of the outturn.
Well, hold on a second. This is your budget document that you have published. There's a table in it that tells me in 2010-11, the Scottish Government's total budget was £34.2 billion. In 2017-18, your draft budget is showing a figure of £37.9 billion. How is there a cut, or have you got your sums wrong?
No, I haven't. There is a real terms reduction over the period from when the Tories entered office of around 9.2% in terms of our spend.
But you've repeated that three times. That is not what this table demonstrates.
Well, I'm telling you what the overall reduction is in terms of the real terms.
So how can we believe anything that's in your budget document if there's such a fundamental error in the presentation of the figures?
It's not a fundamental error. These are the Dell figures as we've expressed to you.
So where are they in this table?
The departmental expenditure limits are covered within the position that I've outlined in the draft budget.
But as you'd be well aware, Finance Secretary, depart expenditure limits are only a part of your budget. The figures contained in this table are the total budget figures, which are showing a substantial increase in your spending power since 2010-11. Is that not the case?
I've covered a point around total managed expenditure and how the spending power of the government has been reduced since the Tories entered office in real terms.
Which is not what your budget document says. It
and
says quite the opposite.
I was able to cover that in the announcement to Parliament. And, you know, that is the position that we have had, a reduced position from 2010-11 over a 10-year period. And I have explained the point that between the resource and the capital, for the forthcoming financial year that there is a real terms increase, but set in the context of reductions since, say, 2010-11.
Any of your officials perhaps help?
I think we've had another ping pong here. The Cabinet Secretary's made his point, you made your point. Patrick?
I thought that Mr. Fraser was touching upon the income tax position. I just think it's quite important that Mr. Fraser has mentioned divergence in terms of tax and has put out quite a negative message about position on tax. Of course, the position we've put out is, you know, in terms of we're not passing on the tax cut for some of the richest in society. We're not passing that on in terms of the higher rate threshold. I think that's the right thing to do. But 99% of adults would pay no more tax, given their current level of income, than in 16-17. And you know, the message that Scotland is high tax has really been put out by the Conservatives, and I think that that's unhelpful, when in fact it's the wider package that's important around taxation and, of course, quality of life in Scotland as well. So I think that a message maybe should not be put about by the Conservatives, because certainly Scotland continues to be a good place to live, work, invest and do business.
Deliberately about this process at this stage. Patrick.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to talk about tax as well, perhaps from a slightly different perspective from Mr. Fraser. What are the objectives of Scottish Government income tax policy?
Well, in terms of how we've arrived at our tax position, we look at the expenditure, what are the policies we want to achieve, the manifesto delivery, and the new tax powers that we have within that to help balance the position. We've taken, a fair and reasonable approach on taxation to use our powers responsibly. We don't believe it's been the right thing to do to pass on the Tory tax cut in terms of the high rate threshold, but to give certainty and stability in terms of the rates. And at this time of uncertainty, we have the continuity on the rates and bands, but ensured that we are able to generate more income through a different position on tax from the UK government. And that will generate, following the work of the block grant adjustment, around £79 million.
Yeah, I'm not really interested in UK government income tax policy for their jurisdiction. I'm interested in Scottish Government policy for Scotland on in terms of income tax. You've talked about raising enough revenue for your manifesto commitments as an objective, and you've talked about stability. You haven't said anything about progressive taxation and closing the inequality gap in Scotland. Is that part of the objective of your government's income tax policy? Is progressive taxation SNP policy, and does the zero change position on income tax rates and bands reflect the fact that your view is that income tax policy is sufficiently progressive at present?
No, I think what we've put through the manifesto on which we were elected is our current proposition, but our income tax policy, of course, is taken year to year. I did cover in my opening remarks the principles that we follow around ability proportionate to the ability to pay as well. And as part of that, of course, progressivity is part of that. So we will continue to look.
Which implies that you think income tax is sufficiently progressive at present.
What I've said is that our position on income tax remains under review, and we have, for example, on the additional rate, said that we'll look at the evidence around this and the assumptions and the analysis to ensure that if we were to take a different approach, for example, on the additional rate, that we wouldn't lose any income as a result. So our position is, as outlined in the draft budget from the manifesto through the course of the election, that is what we are putting forward. It does have to be. I know Mr. Harvey says you're not particularly interested in what the UK government does, but of course there is the relationship with the block grant adjustment to ensure that we actually raise revenue. We don't take an unnecessary risk, but I say again that, of course, progressivity is certainly part of the mix, and it will remain under review.
So why is it a good idea, for example, for there to be only one income tax rate between the personal allowance and 43,000?
Well, we're not proposing to change the bands and rates at this time. I don't, you know, believe that the structure that we have inherited, and yes, the government can change, is absolutely perfect, but I think that I think taxpayers face a lot of uncertainty at this time and around the principles of certainty and convenience, efficiency and progressivity in terms of ability to pay are all important. And I think we can have further discussions about what the income tax structure looks like in the future, but what we've proposed, we believe, commands the support of the people through the election.
I recognise that you've inherited this, you can put it that way, but these are now your policy proposals. These are the rates and bands that your government is proposing for the future. Why is it a good idea that only one rate exists between that personal allowance and the high income threshold? Why would it not be a more progressive idea to reduce income tax for low earners or even for average earners and increase it modestly for those who are on higher incomes up to the high income threshold?
Well, I know that Mr. Harvey has different proposals on income tax, as do the other parties, which includes, for others, raising the basic rate. We're not proposing to do that. We're proposing to freeze the rates that we feel is fair at this time. And we feel that this current proposition gives us and taxpayers certainty and reliability in terms of income. Yes, this Parliament is now empowered to change the rates and the bands and the thresholds if it so chooses, but what we are putting forward, we believe, gives stability and certainty, and by not passing on the tax cut through the higher rate threshold as proposed by the Conservatives, we believe at this stage is the right balance.
Yeah, you keep using this phrase, passing on. There isn't any passing on involved. There is the setting of Scottish income tax policy by your government and by a rate resolution that would be passed by this Parliament. This is something that's set here in Scotland now. It's not about passing anything on. You've talked about increasing the threshold on the higher rate by inflation. That's the maximum of what you said was to be considered in your manifesto. You said increasing by a maximum of inflation. Why are you doing the maximum of what you set out as something worth considering in your manifesto?
Well, what we're doing is in line with inflation, as I say, we'll take tax decisions year to year, and that's the position that we've put across at the moment.
Why though?
Well, that's the figure in line with inflation. That feels like the right thing to do in a balanced way. Because it feels like the right thing to do that is our
right
judgment of what's fair and balanced. Mr. Harvey has a different view on the structure of income tax. We feel that fits within our manifesto commitment, that commands the support of the people, is fair and gives certainty at this time.
Why increase the higher rate threshold by inflation but not the additional rate threshold? If there's a principle involved in sticking to inflation, surely you do both, not one and not the other.
Well, we didn't have changing the additional rate threshold within the manifesto, so what I'm delivering is the manifesto that I was elected on. And
I'll give you a reason why.
Okay. One of the reasons why is I think that the change on the threshold for the higher rate would generate more income than the change on the threshold for the additional rate because of the number of people who would be paying that, I suspect.
Sorry, you're saying increasing the threshold increases the revenue. Surely it decreases the revenue.
In terms of the block grant adjustment position relative to the rest of the UK, that was my point about what we do is relative to what the UK government does on tax policy.
I'm sorry, Finance Secretary, are you saying that increasing the higher rate threshold by inflation will increase the revenue from higher rate taxpayers? Surely the opposite is true.
What I'm saying is that because of the block grant adjustment, what we do is relative to what the UK government, in terms of what they do, and therefore the figure that we arrive at, the two are have a relationship to each other, and that's why I've used the language of not passing on the Tory tax reduction in terms of changing the higher rate threshold to a higher level than is the case in Scotland, and that's what generates the difference.
So you're accepting, though, that freezing the threshold would generate more revenue than your policy proposal of increasing it by inflation?
Yes, it would.
Right. Finally, can I just talk about those higher rate taxpayers, of whom, of course, we all have an interest to declare because we are higher rate taxpayers. We're all better off because of the UK government's decision to increase the personal allowance. The poorest people in society gain nothing from that, but everybody up to the £100,000 mark where that personal allowance starts to decline is better off because of that change in the personal allowance. There's also been pay settlements, of course, since your manifesto was written, and higher rate taxpayers are seeing, including ourselves, incidentally, are seeing incomes increase by inflation or above. And they're going to be better off again if we increase the higher rate threshold by anything at all. Why do we need to look after higher rate taxpayers in that way when we're not giving a tax reduction to low earners?
Well, we believe we're supporting low earners through our position on freezing the basic rate, frankly, and that's our position. I know that Patrick Harvey has a view around what the UK government is doing on that, but our position is not to increase the rates for basic rate in Scotland. And in terms of the higher rate, I've set out the position on the thresholds.
Your budget document says your increase in the higher rate threshold of income tax, when combined with the increase in personal allowance, means that low and middle income taxpayers will be protected. How on earth are low and middle income taxpayers protected by an increase in the higher rate threshold? They're not at all affected by it.
But we're not putting the tax rate up, is my point, for basic rate. Other parties propose...
This sentence isn't about the basic rate. I'm quoting specifically. This increase in the higher rate of income tax threshold, when combined with the increase in the personal allowance, means that low and middle income taxpayers will be protected. They're not in any way affected by the higher rate threshold.
Patrick, I've been pretty keen to give you a bit of space. Question, this is the last answer in this session.
Well, Convener, I put it simply that basic rate taxpayers are protected and that we're not putting up the basic rate of tax, and that has been proposed by other parties, but not by this government.
Ashton.
Some of this may already have been touched on, but you've decided in this budget not to increase the additional rate. And obviously this is a time when public finances are under pressure. So I'm wondering if you could explain some of the factors that fed into making that decision.
Well, I think the key issue is an understanding as if we raised the additional rate, would it actually generate more income and get the benefit of a tax increase, albeit from the richest in our society. But the point of it is to ensure that we actually raise the income. And the analysis was that there was a risk that if as much as 5%, if there's a movement of 5% Scottish taxpayers through whatever mechanism, we no longer have that income, then the policy would be counterproductive and we wouldn't be raising any income. So it was that assessment that led government to the opinion that increasing the additional rate at this time was not the appropriate thing to do. However, that policy does remain under review, and we will ask the Council of Economic Advisers to look at the issues and the assumptions and what could mitigate the risks around that so that we could be in a position in future to make a judgment around what any increase might actually generate.
Thank you.
Neil.
Obviously, it's been mentioned that the government and the First Minister have said that you do support there being an additional rate of tax of 50 pence, but for the reasons you've outlined, the behavioural impact and negative effect, you're not proposing it this year. For you to support a 50p tax rate in Scotland, does it require, as things stand, the Chancellor to propose a 50 pence tax rate for the whole of the UK?
Well, again, I would make the point that first of all, I think all members have to understand the block grant adjustment and the outcome of the fiscal framework, that decisions are no longer in isolation in Scotland. They're just around what what we decide to do around tax equals what we spend. It's all in relation to what happens with the UK in terms of tax for tax and the block grant adjustment. So if, of course, the Chancellor was to make a different decision, it doesn't feel as if it's the kind of decision that Philip Hammond will be making any time soon, I have to say, on the additional rate, then of course we have to look at our position, because tax decisions will be taken year to year and in the context of what the UK government's doing as well. So it has to be taken in that context to ensure that we actually raise revenue. There is a political judgment around what is acceptable and what is required to fund public services. But yes, my colleagues in Westminster in the past have opposed the reduction to the additional rate. And we will keep that position under review in terms of the Scottish budget based on the analysis around what it would generate. But it's not a dismissive point to say that what we do in income tax has to take into account what the UK government's doing. And if they decide to put the figure up, then our decision also has to be taken in that context. But I don't feel that this particular government will be choosing that as their first tax option.
A number of experts have said it's difficult to accurately quantify behavioural effects in terms of tax without actually introducing those tax changes. You've said you won't introduce a 50p tax rate for those the 17,000 richest people in Scotland this year, but you've not ruled it out for the rest of the parliament. The worry for me, though, is that I think there's a suspicion you don't have any intention of doing it at any point over the next parliament. But in terms of the analysis that you've looked at, it could raise up to £100 million, but in terms of the different effects, you've said it could raise £50 million or it could cost the Scottish Government £30 million. In terms of the impact of a 50p tax rate and your analysis of that, you're saying you're waiting for analysis and evidence. What exactly are you waiting for? What has to change in the analysis that you've got in order for you to support a 50 pence tax rate for those earning over £150,000 a year?
Well, I think any reasonable person would want assurance that it will actually generate income and then more certainty around what level of income that might generate. And as I say, income tax decisions and all tax decisions will be taken year to year. And in our manifesto, we made it clear that the position on the additional rate would remain under review, and it will. So based on the advice that we receive around the scenarios, around the certainty of a tax collection, around the best analysis on tax behaviours and minimising avoidance and ensuring through HMRC that we have absolutely got assurance around the residency and that we can't just have that movement of taxpayers elsewhere to avoid any increased Scottish rate, then all of that will be borne in mind. But the first position would be, is there certainty around how much it would raise, and is that positive to Scotland? Then, of course, all the other decisions that are taken into account in determining a tax policy is also what you spend and what is required to balance the books.
Can I just clarify something? In response to Ash Debenham, you said if there was a 5% reduction in additional rate taxpayers in Scotland paying tax in the rest of the UK, or whatever, that would reduce the income, the revenue to the Scottish Government. My understanding was you modelled two things. It was a 5% reduction would have actually resulted in a £50 million increase in revenue. Could you clarify that?
Well, the information I have is that the analysis published in March showed that for 2017-18, losing only 1,000, around 5% of additional rate taxpayers would mean that a 50p additional rate would not raise any extra revenue.
Okay.
James.
Okay, thanks. You said at the start, Cabinet Secretary, that you'd taken progressive decisions, but is it not the case that because you've shied away from using the new tax powers, we now know that councils have got less money and will therefore need to make cuts, and that will affect local jobs and services because you've not been prepared to use the tax powers of the Parliament progressively?
Well, I think that local government has a very fair settlement. I'll continue to engage with COSLA, the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, on that. I've also written to each local authority on whether they accept the offer that I've made to them or not. The deadline for that is 20th of January. And I believe that when you look at the total package for local government services, it's a very strong and a fair one. Local government, like other public services, will be dealing with a financial situation with increased pressures on services and all the extra pressures that come along with that, such as UK government decisions, for example, around the apprenticeship levy. But on the actual settlement to local government, I think it's a good one and a strong one, and I think we've got the balance right. If it was such a bad deal for local government, I'm sure that COSLA would have rejected it.
I'm not going to go through the local government expenditure side of things, because obviously we've got a separate session on that. My point is that this session is about revenues, and you've made certain tax choices, and based on that you then have to map out your budget based on what you've raised. And as a result of you limiting how much you look to raise through taxation, there are cuts. Even SNP politicians have acknowledged that councils will have less money to spend. So as a consequence of the decisions you've made around taxation, then there are going to be cuts in the budget. And, people in local communities are going to suffer because of that. Do you recognise that?
There are more resources for local government services, and when we get into expenditure, I'm quite happy to cover that on an authority-by-authority basis, if Mr Kelly so wishes to do. And I'll be able to show how the package of support to local authorities is a fair one and will support local services. I think the package is a fair one between the non-domestic rates, the council tax position and the government settlement, and the extra support in an area such as the attainment fund targeting on education as well. So I think it's a fair settlement, and it's one that I think will be supported by local communities, because actually for local government services there will be more resources as a consequence of this draft budget.
Okay, let me put it another way. What drove you to reach your taxation decisions, which have raised an amount of money? I would argue it's limited. You would argue that it's adequate. But what drove you to, what was the thinking behind that taxation policy, bearing in mind there are consequences for the rest of the budget?
Well, government's first point of reference surely is its manifesto on which it was elected. Now, of course, we are a minority government, and any budget will have to get the support of Parliament. But our first position is to look at the manifesto. That is then covered through the programme for government and delivering on those commitments and those policies. In doing that, we look at our tax position and what we had put to the people we were doing around revenue, and we work on it simultaneously to produce a budget that considers our commitments and our policies around revenue and taxation, ensuring that there is enough resource to adequately fund our public services, meet our commitments, and also in viewing taxation, do it in a fair way that still ensures Scotland is competitive and attractive and is delivering a fairer country.
You didn't stand on a manifesto of cuts to local jobs and services, so surely you should set your tax plans accordingly.
Really, I've been able to express, and I'm happy to do it in more detail when we cover expenditure, how we've actually put more resources into local government services, and that does include the work in the integration joint partnerships around health and social care integration. I assume there is support for in Parliament around that integration journey on social care, and through the changes we've made on council tax as well, and the ability to raise council tax by 3%, all of that will mean real money, real cash support for local government services. And I say again, I think local government has had a good, a fair and a strong deal from the draft budget. I'm not dismissing that there are challenges within the public sector. I think we all face challenges in these difficult economic times, but I think the settlement is a strong one, and one in which we've looked at the issues before us and given a large degree of protection for local government.
I've got a couple of supplementaries in this area. Now, Willie, Coffey.
Thanks very much. Cabinet Secretary, could you outline for us some of the other examples of how taxes in Scotland across the board are actually less than the rest of the UK? I'm thinking about things like the council tax, for example, which is 12% lower in Scotland than it is in England, and it's 32% higher, apparently, in Wales, things like that. The tuition fees is effectively a tax. Business rates are lower in Scotland. Prescription charges are effectively a tax. So the notion that Scotland is the highest taxed part of the UK is really nonsense when you look across the kind of broad kind of horizon of some of these elements that really impact in the money that's in people's pockets.
Well, even on income tax, the income tax proportions for higher rate earners is 10%. So I wouldn't accept the charge that Scotland is, you know, the highest tax part of the UK. And certainly when you take it into the context of everything else, and of course the quality of life policies, the social contract issues, some of which you've touched upon. So you're not higher taxed if you need free personal care, or if you want, you know, you to be going through university, or if you happen to be sick and needing a prescription, just by way of some examples. And even on council tax, even after the changes that this Parliament supported around the multipliers and any potential council tax increase, it will still, on average, be less than is the case in England, which I think does show that Scotland remains to be attractive. And looking at the totality of tax and spend policies that we have, we've struck, I think, the right balance. But essentially, we do believe in a social contract where you are contributing society, but you get certain social benefits at the point of need.
Thank you.
Now, Dean Dirk, all right, you would have come in earlier in this area as well, did you?
Tax forecasting, if this is the right time to do it.
Ivan, was you supplementary directly what's just been going on?
I was going to talk to Willie's cover, but also
I'll come back to you after that.
Touch on some of the stuff from earlier as well.
You go just now, Ivan.
Yeah, aye. Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks, Cabinet Secretary, for coming along today. I was wanting to ask you about support for business, but before I get to that, I just want to clarify on some of the stuff that was talked about earlier on when Murdo Fraser was talking about cuts to the budget. If I'm not mistaken, I think it's important we clarify this. What Murdo Fraser was talking about was Table 4, which is the total government spend, which and isn't just the settlement from the Treasury, also includes borrowing, tax revenue, etc., etc. And also that table is looking at cash terms, not real terms, obviously. So even when you take those numbers over that seven-year period, the numbers in that table will demonstrate a cut in real terms. But the important number, which is what we're talking about, is a settlement from HMT, which is Table 1.02, which shows it's gone from 29.6 billion in 2010-11 through to 30.9 billion in 2017-18, which is obviously only, I think, a 4% increase in cash terms. And if you look at Table 1.02, it's laid out very clearly that in terms of the real terms change in that Dell settlement from HMT, it's a 7.4% reduction over the 7 years to 17-18, and as you correctly said, a 9.2% reduction over the years to 19-20. Would that be a fair summary of the reality of the situation?
Yes, it would. I don't think Mr. Fraser's happy enough with that answer either, but... Okay.
Okay, just wanted to clarify that for the record.
The Secretary respond first and then I'll let you ask your question.
Well, yes, I mean, that covers the points that Mr. McKee has raised, and I've covered, as I said, in the statement in which I have more information around the total discretionary budget that we have. So, you know, I think we can argue about the relative cuts to Scotland's budget in terms of what we've received.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. McKee said if you look at the real terms figures, there's still a real terms cut. I don't believe that's correct, because Spice very helpfully gave us the comparative figures in real terms for 2016-17 prices. Again, looking at total Scottish Government budget, this shows us in 2010-11, in real terms, this is 2016-17 prices. The outturn for 2010-11 is 37.229 billion. In your draft budget, the figure, again, for total spend, in real terms, 37.401. So in real terms, your total budget is still up on 2010-11, which reinforces my point that your claims about austerity and cuts are somewhat lacking in evidence.
Well,
can I just clarify that myself? Is that figure is the same figure that's on the table, is it not, on page 172, which includes AME, etc., in the number, annual managed expenditure, which you've no discretion?
Yeah, there's no discretion over AME. It's needs-based. And
but it's still part of the budget. Down.
Well, it's needs-based, and it's quite different from the discretionary spend that the government has at its disposal. And Mr. Fraser knows the difference.
Yeah, but it's still part of your total budget.
It's quite different from the
discretionary. Which has gone up in real terms.
But Mr. Fraser, you know, it's quite different from the discretionary spend that the government has at its disposal.
I'm on Groundhog Day. I'm going to go to Dean now.
I know that Mr. Fraser's trying to kind of level an argument that this benevolent UK government has always been kind to Scotland and we deserve no more resource. I would argue something quite different.
I'm simply demonstrating what the evidence shows us.
Ivan, had you finished your question, first of all? Sorry. So, on you go.
Just to on that point, that's the point I made. The if you look at the total budget, but the total budget isn't the issue. The issue is a settlement from HMT, which is a completely different number. And the reason the Scottish Government has managed to keep it on a level keel in real terms over the period is because of what they've done in other areas to generate revenue. But in terms of what's come from Westminster, it's a significant cut. The main point of my question was round about to ask, obviously, productivity and growth is a key issue going forward. And it was to ask the Cabinet Secretary just to go into a bit more detail. I've already touched on it, round about support for business relative to the rest of the UK, making Scotland the most attractive place to do business, be that on business rates or be that on the small business bonus or be it on LBTT from a non-residential point of view.
So I was able to cover some of the business rates decisions around cutting the poundage overall. So not insisting on a revenue neutral revaluation comes at a cost, but it's the right thing to do in terms of that reduction for the poundage. Of course, there's the increasing of the thresholds for eligibility for small business bonus, and that's anticipated that will take 100,000 properties. You know, out of rates altogether. The changes to the large business supplement, and I know that others wanted me to go further. I wasn't able to do that, but the changes to the large business supplement, increasing the threshold there to 51,000, matching that, will ensure that around 8,000 properties are taken out of that. So I think that's a very comprehensive package on business rates. And I described separately the other initiatives around the Scottish Growth Scheme, around focus on attracting further investment, on recalibrating our economic strategy to target growth opportunities as well, and ongoing capital investment has made a difference in difficult years as well, particularly around infrastructure spend, and that very much continues, of course, with some of the major projects coming to completion. We've touched upon the city deal work, and there's other financial mechanisms that I want to continue with and explore, such as around tax incremental finance or finance or growth accelerator models, and there can be other, you know, issues such as guarantees that the government's been able to provide, which has supported specific interventions. And as I say, there'll be further work to try and support our productivity, whether that's on digital or bespoke packages from the enterprise agencies for the individual companies as well. And as part of all of that, of course, we've got a particular direction of travel around the business pledge, and part of that's around quality and living wage and accreditation and so on. So I think there's a range of measures that will support productivity, but a major impact, as we have discussed at this committee, has been the impact on oil and gas specifically, and not just leave, for example, the decommissioning opportunities to someone else, but to try and ensure that we have a strong part in that opportunity as well.
Great, thank you. The
Sorry, you.
Yeah, just a supplemental. Thank you, Convener. Looking at economic growth, one of the key things we need to do is to encourage companies to scale up, but the Large Business Supplement acts as a disincentive for companies to grow beyond a certain size. And even after increasing the threshold, there are still 20,000 businesses in Scotland subject to the Large Business Supplement, making Scotland the highest tax part of the UK for those companies of that size. Can I ask, by changing the threshold 9 months after this policy was introduced, isn't this a recognition that this tax has failed and that it is actually damaging business, as the Scottish Retail Consortium have said?
Mr. Lockhart has very helpfully changed the language there of the Tory position to not being the largest, the highest tax part of the UK, but just the highest tax part of the UK just for properties of
in the context size. In the context of this tax.
All right, okay, fair enough, Mr. Lockhart, but I know that your language was probably more accurate when you were saying just the properties of that size, apart from the fact, of course, that the poundage for those properties comes down because the overall poundage comes down. So that benefits every ratepayer paying non-domestic rates overall. So ideally, in an ideal world, I would rather not have a higher level of large business supplement, ideally, but it would come at a cost, and I would simply put it back to the Conservatives to say, well, what would you replace that with? Because it would come at a cost, and it would require resources to be found from elsewhere in the budget or somewhere else in tax to pay for it. So I feel that the package that I've put across is fair and proportionate. Yes, it has protected small businesses, and it will lift more businesses out of taxation. It is a poundage reduction for everyone, and fewer people will pay the large business supplement. But of course, those paying that would rather not have that differential rate. But I feel that the overall package is very competitive and good for Scotland.
But would you recognise that this could act as a disincentive for companies expanding beyond a certain level? Because after they expand beyond a certain level and start paying this additional large business supplement, that might not make it economic or business sense to scale up. So that, going back to your case, economic case for and the vital need to for our companies to scale up, this is acting on the feedback from business. 13 organisations earlier this year or last year wrote a letter to you saying this tax is damaging business. Isn't there a recognition on the government side that this tax is damaging the expansion of business in Scotland?
Well, first of all, I would say that business rates would only be part of a decision of a company to either upscale or to move. So no, I don't think it will be a major impediment to business growth, especially taken in the context. Even if you just look at Scotland, it is less expensive, generally speaking, to do business in Scotland than it is in England. So I think it has to be taken within that context, as with all the other decisions that will be, all the other issues that will be taken into account when a business decides to grow. But of course, that many of those organisations that signed the letter around the large business supplement will welcome the change in threshold, and that's part of this budget. I wonder if the Conservatives will be voting against that change in threshold, because I think that that has been welcome, as have some of the other measures in my budget in relation to business rates. So no, I don't think it's a major impediment to growth. It has been collected, and it is within the wider context, a very competitive business rates position in which I'm reducing the overall poundage and all the other measures that I've spoken about. But I have reflected on the views given to me by the business community, and that's why I'm proposing a change to the threshold. To go further would mean a tax rise elsewhere or a reduction in public expenditure, and I'd be interested in what the Conservatives think that should be.
Just in terms of latest feedback from business, the SRC has said this budget has fumbled the opportunity to reverse the doubling of the large business supplement, which they say is damaging business. So that's the latest feedback from business in terms of their reaction to even the increased threshold. And can I ask, what was the rationale behind choosing 51,000 as the increased threshold? Was there a particular reason why 51,000 was chosen?
51,000, as it happens, matches the threshold in England, so that feels like an appropriate figure. So that's the reason that I've chosen that figure. But in terms of SRC's opinion on the wider package of business rates, I would look at their view on the overall approach to taxation, and you'll find support from some, if not all, of the policies that I've put forward in the draft budget.
At some stage, but Willie, was you a supplementary to this area before growth schemes? What's still about productivity issues? So we'll go there, and then I'm going to come to Marie on issues to do with borrowing. So on you go, Willie.
Thanks.
Okay, well, you've got a supplementary as well, so I'll let Willie go first. I'll come to you with a supplementary on small businesses, and then you can move on to borrowing.
Thanks very much, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, there was a discussion earlier on in the committee meeting about growth schemes and the impact they could have in regenerating local economies. As you know, the Ayrshire economy lags behind the Scottish economy in a number of factors, and there's been support from the Scottish Government on the Ayrshire Growth Deal, but as I understand it, there's been no equivalent statement of support for the Ayrshire Growth Deal from the UK Government, certainly nothing in the autumn statement. Is that the current position as you understand it, and will you give me an assurance that you'll continue to press the case for Ayrshire with the UK Government to match the commitment that you've already demonstrated?
Well, I appreciate that Mr Coffey is probably advancing a constituency interest there, but I, in fairness, Convener, I think you did mention a Stirling growth scheme, City Deal. So, you have now then, Convener. But in terms of the Ayrshire growth deal, so there are talks ongoing. Scottish Government is engaged, is interested. That I didn't see anything in the Chancellor's autumn statement. Of course, he did point out to me that it's a statement, not necessarily a full budget. And that this year, of course, there'll be two budgets. Maybe there'll be mention in that, but we continue to work. I described it earlier on in my remarks as organic and quite bespoke, and I think that will be another example of a bespoke arrangement. But yes, we're continuing to engage as a government on it, particularly my colleague who has the lead here, Keith Brown, the Economy Secretary.
Marie Toy.
Thank you. I just wanted to welcome the protection that you've put forward for small businesses, and also ask you about the relief measures for rural businesses and for renewable businesses. What impact do you expect that to have in terms of growing the economy?
I wanted to ensure that we could, on the rural relief and on digital, at least match what the UK government was doing, so we weren't at any disadvantage. So there is further clarity to be given by UK government on exactly how that works, but certainly the policy intention is to match that, and that of course is in addition to all the other measures that I've described earlier.
Thank you.
You wanted to cover borrowing as well, I think.
Yes, just simply we'll talk next week about what we plan to spend our new borrowing powers on, but I just wanted to clarify with you, there are new borrowing powers available to the Scottish Government. Do you intend to use them fully?
Yes, we intend to use them in terms of our new powers from the Scotland Act. We will use them to the max. Our proposal is to set out further spending plans around borrowing, and we fully anticipate to use them to the cap of £450 million and mindful of the aggregate borrowing cap of £3 billion. So we do intend to use them over the course of the year.
Okay, I'm not seeing any indication of any other colleagues wanting to ask any.